IVM.
We would like to thank HDFC Life Insurance for supporting this show. HDFC Life Insurance has created an online video series called Behind the Journey with some of the most interesting people from the creative and entertainment industry. It explores the stories that are behind the glitz and glamour of the spotlight and screaming fans. Let's listen to a snippet from the episode featuring actor Jitendra Kumar.
Initially, जब मैं बहुत ऐसे कुछ चीज नहीं वर्क कर रही है एक्टिंग में तो मैं बहुत पैनिक कर जाता था तो काफी लोग मुझे सलाह देते थे कि नहीं मतलब उतना पैनिक मत कर मतलब धीरे धीरे ग्रो करेंगी चीजें तो जिस तरह से तुम्हारा काम धीरे धीरे ग्रो करता है एक दिन में नहीं चीजें मिलती हैं आई थिंक तुम्हारा जो फाइनेंशियल साइड है उस पर भी तुम्हें ध्यान देना चाहिए और वो भी धीरे धीरे डेवलप होता है वो भी एक दिन में नहीं होता और वो होने लगता है
As Jitu said, steady growth is a good sign for both your finances and the journey of your dreams. You can watch all episodes of Behind the Journey on HDFC Life Insurance YouTube channel. That's youtube.com/HDFC Life. Take control of your personal goals with HDFC Life Insurance's financial solutions. Plan now with HDFC Life Insurance.
Terms and conditions apply. HDFC Life Insurance Company Limited, IRDAI, registration number 101.
Welcome to All Things Policy, a daily podcast by the Takshashila Institution. We are a bunch of policy nerds based in Bengaluru, and we like bringing fresh perspectives to Indian affairs and Indian perspectives to global affairs. So grab a cup of coffee, sit back, and join us for today's chat.
Hello and welcome to All Things Policy. You know, we talk about nukes quite a bit on this podcast, but we rarely talk about nukes in Western Europe. But we've been given occasion to do so by the wonderful President of France, because earlier this month, at a speech at France's War College, he called on Europe to take on a more active role in thinking about nuclear deterrence, and he called for a strategic dialogue on the issue. To discuss this with me, what it means, whether it means anything, I have with me Nischitha and Pranav. Hi, guys.
Hello.
Hi.
All right. I'm going to start with you, Nischitha. What drove the President of France to make this speech? And what does he really plan to get out of it? And what's the environment in which this speech and this talk is really happening?
Okay. So this speech is given by every president, France president, It's like a yearly thing that they do. And I think his remarks came about the time when he realized there were high security tensions, there were proliferation of international arms control, extreme regional security crisis again in and around his neighborhood, and other such issues that maybe threatens not just France's stake, but also the entirety of the Europe. He, in his speech, he advocates for something called as the strategic autonomy from the US. And this especially comes about a time when US Trump, when he made a statement where he said he doesn't want to engage with NATO and his reactions to the same. So he feels like Macron feels like he needs to take over the nuclear umbrella from them. And he feels like a sole leader, given the fact that after the Brexit, France is the only sole power right now, and this is the time when he wants to take on a more leadership role, also to show his domestic people that he has a more stronger role to play than the rest of the European leaders.
Of course, Brexit means that the UK is out of the European Union, but they're still very much within NATO. And obviously, the British and French continue to work very closely. Pranav, what is this international environment that Macron is talking about?
So, we've spoken about arms control many times on this podcast. We've covered every death of every single arms control that's happened in the past 2 years, right? Currently, what's happening is that the US doesn't really seem to show that kind of commitment that it once used to NATO. Especially Mike Pence last year, he made a statement where he said the other members of NATO have to commit to the 2% that they'd promised to spend. And the signals that have been given by Trump is generally that NATO is not doing enough. We have our troops there. We send so many of our troops there, but they do not show the same kind of commitment, especially when you have Russian aggression. Now, they do talk about Russian aggression, which is very much correct. In 2014, we had the salami tactic of annexing Crimea. And the tension now is Russia could get more aggressive. The INF treaty is dead. So Russia already has the 9M729 missile, which could strike Europe. During all this, the US, when the US commitment is just going away, or it feels like it's going away, the Europeans are really tensed. The British, as far as we know, only the launch authority is independent, but their forces are very much integrated to the American nuclear strategy and NATO. So I think what the Europeans are looking for, especially Germany, which is very much threatened by Russian acts, would probably look for something that's more independent, something what we call the Eurobomb. The Eurobomb concept, I don't think would happen because, you know, the Western Europe has a strong NPT commitment and they have a strong non-proliferation norm. But what you could see is this dialogue on how France could take up a larger role in this commitment to Europe. Because France is the only country with a sizable nuclear arsenal and they have a strategy to deter Russia in any form. So I think under this environment, Europe would look for some sort of independence, especially when Europe has sort of lost some of its prestige from what it used to have during the Cold War. We have America, you have China, and Europe is somewhat rarely talked about. Whenever people talk about Europe, they only talk about all the problems with Europe. So I think having this powerful Europe in one sense would actually bring back some of that prestige.
Yeah, it's really interesting to me that the danger to Germany is invoked over here, because every time the French start talking about having common EU defense policy or start talking about nuclear weapons, the Germans and the British are the first people to say, don't worry, there's NATO. So obviously there's something there about French politics. You know, I also find there's a contradiction, fundamental contradiction really, in France trying to basically protect Europe, because if you look at what the driving force behind the French nuclear deterrent is, part of it is strategic autonomy. And the French are very committed to maintaining the autonomy of their decision making, of actually having the office of the president have a great deal of say, a great deal of discretion in how to use those nuclear weapons. And the ambiguity that ensues from that is, in French eyes, something that enhances deterrence. And, you know, obviously, their nuclear weapons are meant to deter much stronger conventional forces as well as nuclear forces of other countries. It's very hard to reconcile this with the idea of a common European nuclear deterrent, a common European nuclear weapons policy. But I actually want to go back to the origins of the French nuclear deterrent. Nischitha, how did France's nuclear deterrent work in the environment of the Cold War?
Okay, so I think during the time of the Cold War, the game or the role France played was a lot smaller, in the sense that they knew US was going to take the main stage and UK was the other nuclear power. Even though US had its nuclear capabilities in different bases all across Europe, France and UK had very minimal of those. So even today, they feel like they don't have that much capability that US does. So they still do feel threatened by the fact that they don't have as many warheads as they should be having, while compared to how many US has or had in terms of, you know, the whole NATO nuclear sharing power. So during the Cold War, the situation was defined pretty clearly. They knew they had to keep the Russians out. They knew what was the threat. But right now, the threat itself seems to be on a larger scale, and they don't know how to define these threats, in the sense that it is not just Russia, but also other regional security issues that they are also facing. So from Cold War to post-Cold War, I think the situation has changed drastically, and how people look at the whole issue of who should use and how you should use nuclear weapons in itself. But given in the recent times, given Trump's stance or what the US wants, they just don't want to be part of the US. So French believe that one, US calling out on NATO, two, Russia's Crimea annexation and the Brexit and France being the only sole power. So French are trying to find a middle ground as to show that Europe is still unified, that they are not just dependent on superpowers like the US, or, you know, just solely dependent on even on the UK to a larger extent. So maybe they are trying to bring Europe together in a more larger political and economic scale, and They believe that if they take a stance on neurodeterrence as something together, they might be able to take over or defeat. They don't have to be dependent on the rest of the world or the West as such, or they don't have to answer to anybody, I think is one of the major things.
So just to summarize the arguments that both of you have made, one, you have nuclear arms control agreements that are in trouble, including the INF agreement, which is hugely consequential in Europe. And two, you have isolationist tendencies in the United States. You have Europe being decentered from its old position in the world. And so Macron is trying to reassert some part of Europe's importance or vitality. But tell me, Pranav, how did the French actually, back in the heyday, structure their nuclear forces and think about their nuclear weapons?
So the French strategic thought around nuclear weapons basically was around three key tenets, right? The first one was deterrence of the strong by the weak. So they had a very small arsenal back then. 1952, the British went nuclear, and 1960, the French went nuclear. And around 1965, when they started getting their SSBNs, they were still a very small nuclear power. And that was the first thing, that even with a small nuclear arsenal, nuclear weapons were revolutionary enough that you could actually deter a larger aggressor like the Soviet Union. The second one, which is connected to the first, is the proportionality of damage. So this is sort of similar to assured destruction, but the term assured destruction is never used. It's that if you're attacked by an adversary, your nuclear weapons can be used to deliver a proportional amount of destruction, which would be unacceptable for the adversary, and therefore the adversary would back down. And finally, you have this azimuth or strike anywhere strategy, right? They wanted the French nuclear arsenal, that especially the submarine base and the aircraft, to almost strike anywhere around the world. They didn't specify who the adversary was. They just said that France now has the capability to deter an aggression anywhere around the world. And this is where things get very interesting. De Gaulle was one of the proponents of Force Frappe, and he actually resisted any form of attachment with NATO. 1966, the withdrawal from NATO integrated forces started. 1967, it was finally completed. But de Gaulle was not fully against an integrated NATO force. He just wanted a NATO force to be outside the NATO system, where NATO leaders could be consulted on nuclear matters. And in some form of arrangement outside NATO, US, UK, and France could together get their nuclear arsenals pooled and deter the Soviet Union in some form or the other. But the larger thinking was that it's French sovereignty that comes first, French independence that comes first, and only then you think about the larger European community. That's how the strategy was shaped, and that's how it formally stuck. More interestingly, in 2009, Sarkozy, in his speech, again delivered in the War College, he said that we should not be stuck in the age of de Gaulle when the situation was different, and they formally integrated with NATO once again. So what I think is that France was really, really scared of US abandonment. As you mentioned earlier, it's contradictory to what they're saying now. If you think about what they were saying during the Cold War, and if you compare it to what they're saying today, what you would expect is France to say, Germany, go build your own nuclear weapons. Netherlands, go build your own nuclear weapons. But they're not doing that. So that's the strategic thoughts that's changed. One thing that I've read on a forum on Twitter is some of the French experts saying that this is an evolution rather than a revolution, because France always had this idea of protecting Europe, which came secondarily. And I think it's taking a more front stage now. I don't know if that's a simple form of signaling to get other form of commitments from the EU, or is it something else?
Yeah, that's very interesting what you just said about how the French think about nuclear weapons and how protecting Europe, while it's always been there, has been secondary. And really, since the Cold War, the French have since drawn down their nuclear forces. They've changed the structure, right? It's about 80% SSBNs, meaning ballistic missile submarines, and the rest is air delivered. And this, of course, does allow them to continue that all azimuths doctrine. So they continue. It's not a new idea, really. They want to be able to strike anywhere in the world. But I think it's useful to think why on earth Europe needs to have a nuclear deterrent in the first place. What are the threats to Europe that we see at the moment? Typically, people will cite Russia. And, you know, Russia could marginally challenge Europe. Does anybody expect a large-scale invasion? I don't think so. But what they expect are small-scale operations in some of the newer entrants in NATO that border Russia. Now, these operations are obviously not going to require nuclear weapons. What they will require is very mobile and agile conventional forces. They'll require very good political management. They'll require having basically tripwires, soldiers in place in certain areas to deter any potential Russian attack. If you actually look at Russia's own thinking about war with NATO, they don't seem to be very optimistic about keeping it limited. And so I think that when Russia, if and when Russia were to try doing something on the margins of NATO, it would be something that retains some degree of ambiguity, sort of like what they did in the Ukraine.
Yeah, I just think that the threat to Europe has evolved so much that I'm pretty sure the Russians don't think of marching into Europe in any form, in a straightforward form. I think they would look for this continuous destabilization and taking advantage of all form of discontent and disagreement within the EU, and then formally use a subtle method and a proxy method to sort of grab territory, or at least show that they're trying to do something. I just don't think nuclear weapons in any way function in deterring such kind of aggression. This is a completely new form of warfare that we're witnessing. We got a glimpse of that very early in the 2000s with what they did with Estonia, right? And I think that was one of the things. Russia would not use physical force, that they could use other forms of political discourses to inflict the same kind of pain, inflict the same kind of damage, but not use physical force at all.
Yeah, I don't think, firstly, I'm not sure that's warfare. And secondly, I don't think it's new. I think it's an old form of what they would call political warfare back in the day. And this was actually a very continuous threat throughout the Cold War. So that brings up the question, why on earth is Macron talking about nuclear weapons right now? To my mind, of course, I'm sure this has nothing to do with Yellow Vest protests and so on. But there is a value in talking about nuclear weapons in Europe, which is a simple act of talking about nuclear weapons, having a strategic dialogue, is a display of your will to a potential adversary. So it has a political benefit, a political deterrent effect. And we've seen this very often. The whole idea of nuclear weapons, A, it provides reassurance to your own allies, and B, it provides some sort of political signal to an adversary. And I think if we were to find a rationale for what the French president is doing right now, it must be that. But Nischitha, could there be other reasons?
There can be other reasons. I think Macron is also looking at how, if a fully equipped, nuclear equipped EU would be a sort of a new supreme sovereign power, and that itself, and if it comes down from his own place, his own state, then I think he might feel like he has a larger stake. And given the fact that his approval ratings have dropped down to almost 25%, I think he wanted to put out a very strong message out there saying, I'm not just sitting down and not doing anything about the security threats that's going about. But as you mentioned, the Yellow Vests have taken a longer stand in the sense that they've been going on for almost a year. So when I was back in Paris, this happened for good 6 months continuously, and there was disruption of public transport. Your normal daily life was just wrecked, and it wasn't easy to go about doing your everyday mundane things. So Macron feels like he needs to make up for that by putting out a stronger narrative, I guess.
I just think, and it's very early reflections, that I think what the Europe would try to get out of this is some sort of dual track approach, somewhat like what we had during negotiations of the INF treaty, where NATO and the European countries started negotiating with the Soviet Union on what they could do about shorter range and intermediate range missiles. I think right now the dialogue would be somehow to kickstart arms control talks once again. And as you mentioned, just talking about nuclear weapons somewhat sends a strong signal that, hey, look, we have the resolve to do something. And it's very early stages because to say that this might be a dual track approach, because even the American deployment of the lower yield nuclear weapons could be a form of dual track, where the US would deploy these lower yield warheads in an attempt to get Russia to agree to bring some of their tactical nuclear weapons into the arms control fold. There are many possibilities of that. But one way to initiate arms control talks would probably be to start off talking about a European deterrent.
Yeah, I wouldn't discount what you said at all, because you have the NP review conference coming up in April.
Yes.
And the French do need to get the rest of Europe on board, maybe have a common vision about what role France's nuclear weapons will play in European security. So I think that there are lots of good political motivations, both external and internal, as Nischitha pointed out. Okay, so that's a very interesting conversation. Thank you so much, Nischitha and Pranav. And thank you for joining us on All Things Policy.
If you liked our show, don't forget to check out other interesting podcasts on the IVM network. You can tune into them on the IVM Podcast app, ivmpodcast.com, or wherever you listen to your podcasts. You can also follow IVM on social media. The handle is @IVMPodcasts on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. And hey, if you'd like to dive into Takshashila's research on technology, strategy, and economic affairs, check us out at our Twitter handle @TakshashilaInst or our website takshashila.org.in.
I hope you enjoyed that show. We'd like to thank our sponsors this week, HDFC Life and Paytm Money. And let me tell you a couple of things that you should check out this week. On Litnama, Lakshmi talks to Hardik Vaghela and Mohammed Munim from the band The Words of Alif. They talk about how the band came to be and more. On Football, the guys talk about Liverpool qualifying for the Champions League, City getting banned from it, and Arsenal thrashing Newcastle for a 4-0 win. On Golgappa, tune into a Laugh Riot episode where host Tripti talks to Karan and Neil from Paripa. On our Kannada podcast Thale Harate, Ramya Bhaskar and Sridhar Pabisetti talk to Ganesh and Pawan about reimagining school education for Industry 4.0. On Tapri Tales, Madhuri tells a tale of her struggle with keeping cockroaches away from the kitchen while wondering why there are no cockroaches in her mother's kitchen. On Beyond Cliché, Almas is joined by the Mahiwe actor Pushti Shakti to talk about beauty beyond size. Thanks and keep listening.
Janice, what do you think couples did before TV was invented?
I don't know, go for walks on the beach, long drives, fancy dinners, have more sex maybe?
But what did we do when we decided to move in together? We debated between the Chromecast and the Fire Stick.
We gave up on sleeping early so we could stay up watching true crime shows.
We got ourselves 3 cat babies.
And basically became the cutest couch potatoes around.
Okay then.
In case you guys still haven't got it, we are a TV crazy, Netflix loving, binge watching Mr. and Mrs.
I'm Anirudh Guha.
I'm Janice Iquera.
And if like us, you snort TV for breakfast, lunch and dinner, this is the podcast for you.
Tune in every Thursday on the IVM Podcast app or wherever it is that you get your podcast from. This is
Mr.
and Mrs.
Binge Watch.